If you have ovaries and a uterus, chances are you've heard about menopause. But that's something that happens to older people, right? Not you. Well, it turns out that menstruation's curtain call might start much earlier than you realize. And it lasts longer, too. Whether you're trying to avoid pregnancy or just understanding what's happening with your body, figuring out when the heck menopause is coming can be really useful. And the first hint that menopause might be on the horizon is declining fertility. That typically starts around age 35, not 50. It's absolutely still possible to have a baby, but this is when it gets harder for a lot of people. People who are under 30 have an 85% chance of conceiving within a year, which drops to 75% by 30, 66% by age 35, and all the way down to 44% at age 40. Declining fertility starts with your ovaries. If you think way back to health class, you might remember that humans are born with all the immature eggs, or oocytes, they'll ever have in their lifetime. That's around 1 million at birth, which declines to 500,000 by puberty. And by age 37, there's only 25,000 oocytes left. Ovaries are filled with tiny sacs called follicles, and each follicle is pretty much a cocoon for an oocyte. And every month, a handful of these follicles are chosen to work on maturing their egg. But during ovulation, usually only one dominant follicle gets to release its egg, which will travel down the fallopian tube. And you know how the rest of the story goes. So even though only one egg goes down the tube, all those other follicles that were under construction also get lost in a process called follicular atresia. Those follicles didn't make the cut, so they get reabsorbed and those eggs are gone. That means every month during your reproductive years, you're losing a good number of eggs, which is one reason for declining fertility as you age. So the first step towards menopause is a decrease in fertility. And with time, that decrease in fertility from the follicle loss will start to cause symptoms and even mess with your menstrual cycle. Menstrual cycles are a lot more complicated than you'd think, as it turns out. It's not just a little alarm clock that goes off and says, hey, time to feel terrible for a few days. Cells in the follicles, called granulosa cells, make hormones like estradiol, a type of estrogen. In a typical menstrual cycle, estradiol peaks before ovulation, which causes the brain to release gonadotropin-releasing hormone, which then causes the pituitary gland to release luteinizing hormone. That spike in luteinizing hormone is what tells your body to ovulate. So fewer follicles means less estrogen, which could make you miss that spike altogether, so no ovulation. Or your body could try and compensate, and you could end up bleeding more frequently. Either way, this is the start of what's called perimenopause, which is essentially the 1 to 10 years of declining fertility immediately before menopause. At some point, you cross that threshold of too few follicles to maintain a typical menstrual cycle, and that's when you can start to have some wacky cycles. You might have more frequent menstruation, a missed ovulation here or there, longer cycles, missed cycles, and eventually no cycles. All of that falls under perimenopause, and beyond having fewer and older eggs than ever, the variation you start to see in your cycle also means decreased fertility, because at that point you have a moving, shrinking, and intermittently absent dartboard. Everyone is born with a different number of follicles, and people lose them at different rates too, which might be partially why there's so much variation in menopause and perimenopause onset. The average age of menopause in the US is 51, but it can happen anywhere from 40 to 60. You'll know you've hit menopause when you go 12 months straight without a period. Before then, if you're trying not to get pregnant, regardless of fertility declines, you could still conceive, so the official recommendation is to use contraception until you officially reach menopause. But if you're using something like an IUD and don't get periods normally, figuring out when you've reached menopause can be tricky, so the pros recommend to keep using contraceptives until age 55. Variations in perimenopause and full-on menopause means lots of differences in onset and duration. Like, for example, maybe a person's fertility started dipping in their 30s, and perimenopause didn't start until 45, and then they entered menopause soon after at 47. Meanwhile, another person could have had their last child in their late 30s, and then started perimenopause at 47, and menopause at 57. Everyone's bodies are different, so even decades of variation can be totally normal. And then there's the less normal variation too. Menopause is considered early if it starts before the age of 45, and premature if it's before 40. Some people even go through menopause in their 20s, though that's very rare. Since for some people, perimenopause starts younger or lasts longer, The age where it probably ends up on your radar is around 35. That's when they slap you with the very attractive title of Geriatric Pregnancy 2, although recently it's been more politely renamed as Advanced Maternal Age. It's important to note that people of all sexes can have age-related fertility issues. This video is about menopause, but manopause isn't total fiction either. As males age, their testosterone levels begin to fall around 1% each year, though that varies based on things like obesity or stress. It's called andropause, but it isn't super noticeable like menopause can be. A lot of people can have these decreases, but still have normal testosterone levels, or they can be totally asymptomatic. This usually starts in your 30s, but again, this can vary for lots of people. So fertility decreases with age, and those decreases can get on anyone's radar, regardless of sex. With that time frame ironed out, here's what you can expect from perimenopause and into menopause. First, let's talk periods. You may notice irregular cycles, then the occasional skipped period, and towards the end, you can go multiple months without a period. The final step is full-on menopause, which means no period for a full year. More on that in a minute. Just a heads up, we're about to talk about miscarriages. If that's something you'd rather not hear today, you can skip to this timestamp on screen. Perimenopause also comes with an increased chance of miscarriages, also known as spontaneous abortions. Under 30, people have about a 10% chance of miscarriage. That climbs to about 20% by age 38, 30% at 41, and over 50% chance by age 45. The older an oocyte gets, the more likely it is that the DNA inside can break down or even duplicate when it shouldn't. So when that egg meets sperm, degraded DNA can increase the odds of misalignments, leading to increased chances of genetic conditions and miscarriages. Older sperm can have mutations that contribute to miscarriages too, and in general, older eggs and sperm are associated with an increase in birth defects, stillbirth, gestational diabetes, and other complications. Another symptom is hot flashes, which can affect up to 85% of menopausal people. On average, they last just under a decade, though around a third of menopausal people will have them even longer. Lower estrogen levels may cause increased core temperatures and narrower tolerable temperatures, though other research suggests that altered serotonin levels may be what's changing the thermostat. Sleep problems also become a major problem during perimenopause and menopause. Some of that could be chalked up to your run-of-the-mill age-related insomnia, but menopause seems like it might make it worse. The night sweats probably don't help with sleep, and when you add in the increased rates of stuff like anxiety and depression, it all adds up to fewer Z's. That risk of depression is a big one. Some studies show that you're 3 to 4 times more likely to have a depressive episode during perimenopause. And that makes sense, because most of the symptoms of perimenopause are neurological. No, that doesn't mean it's all in your head. I mean, there are literally changes happening in your brain. Estrogen plays a role in regulating a ton of stuff in the brain, from thermoregulation to sleep to memory, so changes in estrogen can send any of that into chaos. Another of the not-so-pleasurable side effects is painful sex, also called dyspareunia. Essentially, less estrogen causes changes in the urinary and vaginal tracts, leading to vaginal dryness, pain during sex, or urinary incontinence. And unfortunately, those can be permanent without some type of treatment. So, let's talk treatment. But before we get to that, here's a quick ad break.
This SciShow video is supported by Brilliant, an online learning platform that helps you build real knowledge through lessons you'll actually remember. It's a trusted source of information, with courses developed by experts from MIT, Caltech, Microsoft, and Google. From their years of experience, you can learn everything from data analysis to programming. You get to learn from the best, no matter what area you're interested in. And they never back off from the cutting edge. In the years that Brilliant has supported SciShow, we've seen them roll out so many lessons on new topics like AI. You can find them all to try for free at brilliant.org/scishow by scanning the QR code on screen or clicking on the link in the video description. And you'll get 20% off an annual premium subscription.
The goal of treatment during menopause isn't to prevent or reverse fertility loss, but to make the transition a bit less miserable, especially for those who have severe or long-lasting symptoms, which is where hormone replacement therapy, or HRT, comes in. This is usually a combination of estrogen or progesterone and can be prescribed to help with things like hot flashes, night sweats, vaginal dryness, and sleep troubles. A 2023 phase 3 clinical trial on progesterone pills found that even though the pills didn't lead to fewer hot flashes or better sleep quality, The participants felt that both of these things improved by the end of the trial. Higher levels of estrogen are linked to higher cognitive performance, and some studies suggest that estrogen supplements during perimenopause can decrease your risk of Alzheimer's disease, although we still don't 100% know why. One 2009 study found that it's important to start HRT before your last menstrual cycle in order to get those cognitive benefits. But the symptoms of perimenopause and menopause aren't caused by estrogen alone, meaning estrogen-based HRT might not get the job done for everybody. Fortunately, there's another kind of hormone therapy that may help. Testosterone. Adding testosterone to the mix seems to address the sex-related concerns for some people. See, your ovaries don't just make estrogen, they also make testosterone. And when the ovaries wind down on the estrogen, they secrete less testosterone too. And since there are testosterone receptors in our brains and genitals, adding a boost of testosterone seems to help address some of the sex-related symptoms of menopause. A 2019 meta-analysis found that taking testosterone treatment after menopause could address a wide array of sexual dysfunction, increasing everything from desire and self-image to pleasure and orgasm. But experts say that testosterone replacement isn't for everyone. If you were looking for relief from pretty much any other menopause symptoms, this isn't gonna do it. And it isn't recommended for people with heart conditions either. Non-hormonal treatments can target specific symptoms, like treating anxiety and depression with antidepressant meds. So, how long does menopause last? Technically, your periods will be paused the rest of your life, and if you have any unexpected bleeding after that time, you should get checked out by a doctor to rule out other problems. After menopause, most doctors say you're in what's called postmenopause. Once you hit that, some of the menopause symptoms may wane, like hot flashes and night sweats, while other symptoms, like vaginal dryness, can persist without treatment. It's important to keep in mind that all of this data refers to populations, not individuals. Every person's situation is unique, and fertility varies greatly, not only by age, but from person to person. And lots of factors outside of age can affect fertility too, like nutrition, weight, and exercise. So you can think of menopause as the end of a long, slow process, rather than a thing that just happens all at once. Your 30s may mark a winding down of the reproductive system, but it doesn't necessarily mean that everything is closed down. And knowledge is power. So now you'll be ready for whatever your changing hormones might throw your way.